This is the fifth talk, public talk, in the academic series of the Bicentenary that the National Committee of the Holy Archdiocese of Australia has organised in relation to the Bicentenary celebrations. The first talk took place in Darwin. The second talk took place in Perth. And then we have three in Sydney, all three here at St. Andrews. There is another one that's going to take place in the last week of June in Melbourne. And hopefully, if everything goes according to schedule, there's going to be one more at the University of Sydney. So today it's the fifth, and we have the pleasure to have with us Dr. Patricia Koromvokis, who you all know very well. She is a lecturer at Macquarie University, the head of the Modern Greek program there. And she said yes to an invitation I sent to her regarding a very specific topic. And the topic is in what sense and in which ways the revolution, the Greek Revolution of 1821, has influenced the formation, the development, and the creation of modern Greek identity. I won't go into the topic because Patricia is going to take us by the hand and, you know, make the trip throughout the last 200 years that have contributed to this formation. But I'm going to say a couple of things on identity, and specifically what was in my mind when I sort of created the brochure, the invitation most of you have seen, the one with the Exodus of Mesologiou and the bust of Dionysius Solomos. Now, identity is one of the most used words in the last 50 years, especially in the social sciences. At the same time, it's one of the most mistreated words during the last 20 years. In a way, it started as a celebration of uniqueness, you know, difference, one's own value. And it ended up being more or less like a bad word to say the least. In the sense that, you know, to have an identity in a way implies that you are fixed in some sort of essentialist terms. And you don't allow for lots of flexibility in your interpersonal or international or intercultural relations. Now, this is a misunderstanding. This is a misunderstanding because identity basically requires what we call to identify. So you need an identification to identify with something. So we see, for instance, this painting of the Exodus of Mesologiou, the great Exodus. And looking at it, you feel, or you don't feel. You think things, you know, or you don't think. It, in a way, attracts you, or it doesn't. You identify, or you don't, with it. If you identify with this painting, in a sense you relate to it, and you relate to everything that it connotes, it denotes, it implies. That's from this identity with something, you create an identification. And this is basically a relation. Now we know that Solomos wrote whatever he wrote, you know, and especially the Ode to Freedom and, of course, the Eleftheri Poliorkimeni, in relation to this moment, this exquisite moment of Mesologi. So, in a way, Solomos is the voice of Mesologi. So what you see in the picture, the painting of Rizakis, you hear, okay, when the Eleftheri Poliorkimeni is recited. Basically, on tonight's invitation, the brochure, I sort of took the liberty and put my own identity. I relate with the specific painting and I relate with Eleftheri Poliorkimeni. To be honest, I believe that most modern Greeks relate with these two moments, instances, of the revolution. And I think that they have been very fundamental, if not the most fundamental, moments in creating our modern Greek identity. That is, our own relationality with our history. Of course, you know, modern Greeks relate with lots of other things. They relate with Byzantium, they relate with ancient Greece. Personally, I think that most, the vast majority of modern Greeks relate directly in an instinctual, let's say, sense with 1821. And only indirectly, or even by default, with Byzantium and ancient Greece, via Mesologi, via Solomos, via the revolution. It's the revolution, this magnificent moment of a fight for freedom that brings alive whatever Greek identity means throughout the centuries. Here I will stop. I want you, everyone, to make Patricia feel welcome. And we are all ears.
Thank you, Vasilis. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to His Eminence Archbishop Macquarie of Australia, and of course to the National Committee for the Bicentenary of the Greek Revolution for organizing this event, and Vasilis Adrachtas for initiating this topic. I would also like to thank everyone, each one of you, for being here tonight, as it is a long weekend Sunday, and long weekends are very important, at least for the Australian identity. I'm very excited and honored to speak about two important aspects and the way that they are interconnected, the Greek Revolution and its bearing to the formation to modern Greek identity. The Greek War of Independence from the Ottomans, like other periods in the history of Greece, has played a significant role in the shaping and understanding of its modern identity. The 200 years that have passed since the Greek Revolution is a very long period, long enough to help us today to bring together and examine the various different and, to be honest, at times conflicting facets of the Greek identity. My presentation will firstly focus on the characteristics of modern Greek identity, which have their roots, as Vasilis said, and their primary forms at the period of the Greek Revolution. And secondly, as an educator, of course, I will present the role of education, and more specifically, the role of books, school textbooks, and museums in disseminating the Greek identity characteristics from generation to generation. In the study of the Greek independence movement, it is important to remember that although Greece has had a place in written history for over two millennia, its formal identity as a nation is less than two centuries old. Greece has always been at the crossroads of cultural exchange, and this has created a large mosaic of identity. interlocking various groups into a cultural Greek realm, dating from the establishment and expansion of the Byzantine Empire. The Orthodox Church, and of course the Greek language, functioned as the two primary factors that bound Southeastern Europe together, creating an expansive multi-ethnic religious and linguistic domain, which in turn led to a loosely defined Greek identity. This Greek identity was allowed to continue under the Ottoman rule due to Istanbul's millet system, which was a policy that allowed religious and cultural freedom at the price of a heavy tax burden. However, it is because of this elasticity in Greek identity, many Greek speakers identified more closely with the regions and specific locals, as well as the socioeconomic conditions under the Ottoman Empire, that we see a regional diversity in the Greek world emerging during the 400 years period of Ottoman influence. The scholarly literature on nations and nationalism is vast, of course. However, in the discussion of the Greek identity and the formation of the state, vital questions can be posed through the seminal work of Benedict Anderson and his idea of the nation as an imagined community. And why it is an imagined community, a nation, according to Benedict? Benedict analyzes the nation not only as an imagined political community, but also one that is simultaneously limited and sovereign. As he explains, the nation is imagined because most of the members of even the smallest nation will never know most of their fellow members, meet them, or even hear of them. Yet, in the minds of each lives, the image of their community. Typically, members of these communities, with the help of print capitalism to disseminate ideas, come together under the basis of several factors. And which are these factors? Language, of course, religion, of course, culture, history, and political ideologies. The paint that you see here is a painting called Dream of a Sunday Afternoon in the Alameda Central Park, and was created around 1946 by Diego Rivera. The Alameda Park, to know, was a Mexico City's first city park. The painting represents three principal eras, not of the Greek history, but of the Mexican history: the conquest, the Porfiriato dictatorship, and the revolution of 1910. I chose this painting for two reasons. Number one, it is in the cover page of Anderson's book, Imagined Communities. And number two, it shows the role of history in shaping national identity. The concepts of nation and national identity were quite different in Greece at the time of the Greek Revolution than those espoused in ancient Greece. The latter was organized in ancient Greece, was organized around small city-states, where borders and territories were not always well defined. As a result, ancient Greeks identified themselves according to the city or the town in which they lived, rather than to a universally understood Greek nation and identity, as you can see in the first picture. The ancient Greeks were, of course, well aware that the people living in these city-states shared cultural similarities, such as religion, language, and common traditions. Nonetheless, competition between and wars among the city-states emphasized their differences. We can see on the left here a detailed map of ancient Greece, which shows how the borders of the territories of city-states follow the mountain ranges of the region. Athens, top right, Sparta, bottom center, were major city-states. In the middle image, we see a map of Roumelia, Greek Romilia, in 1801. Almost all the Balkan Peninsula here was called Land of the Romans by the Ottomans. And in the third image, we see the territorial evolution of the Kingdom of Greece from 1832, so 1832 this was the Kingdom of Greece, growing and becoming bigger, to 1947. What is nation? Nation, according to Ernest Renan, is like an individual, is the culmination of a longest past of endeavors, sacrifices, and devotions. Of all cults, that of the ancestors is the most legitimate, for the ancestors have made us what we are. A heroic past, great men, glory. This is the social capital upon which one bases a national idea. To have common glories in the past and to have, very importantly, a common will in the present. To have performed great deeds together, to wish to perform still more. These are the essential conditions for being people. The Spartan song, we are what you were in the past. We will be what you are in the present, is, in its simplicity, of course, the abridged hymn of every patri. Now, moving from the definition of nation, trying to define what is national identity. Contemporary scholars, such as Benedict Anderson, agree that national identity is linked to the collective cultural identity and shared memories of an ethnic community. Nations are formed around communities that share common religion, language, and set of customs, and are strengthened by the creation of a national history that focuses on the accomplishments of the community's heroes, inventors, scientists, artists, writers, academics, and philosophers. How lucky we are in Greece, we have all these categories. Such effects can be realized and propagated through a national school system and the mass publication of books. Displaying national symbols such as flags, traditional clothing, monuments, images of the nation's past, and the celebration of national and religious holidays can also reinforce them. Such messages implicitly suggest to the members of the nation that they are part of a community of people who put in place the institutions like schools, churches, family life, and others that help the nation as a whole succeed over time. In other words, everyone in the community plays a role, whether directly or indirectly, in the nation's success. In short, after defining what is nation, what is nationality, in short, the people of a nation are bound together by common understanding of another, and a common understanding of their history and culture. In the case of Monte Greek, this was, in the case of Greece, this was manifested. In the case of Greece, this was manifested through well-known historical figures, events, accomplishments, including Socrates, Homer, the Battle of Marathon, the Greek Revolution, the epic, the early Olympic Games, Alexander the Great, democracy, philosophy, the Acropolis, to name a few. Nation can bring together its people by reminding its past difficulties, struggles, and miseries. Unity is formed around a common historical experience, even when that experience involves being oppressed and persecuted. In Greece, and to be honest, as in much of the Balkans, the most important example of this type of unification in the community involves the nation's persecution at the hands of the Ottoman Turks. An in-depth look at different aspects of the country of Greece, such as integratable islands, its historic and vibrant cities, the exciting world of wines here, and much more are depicted in issues, I think they are monthly issues, of the magazine Greece, which is published by the historic newspaper Kathimerini. The editors in the website of the magazine describe the magazine Greece as a source which offers deeply researched articles, travel guides, and insider's secrets about all the tangible and intangible things that make Greece the unique and wonderful place that it is. The editors describe the magazine as a perfect companion to one's exploration of the country, either as a visitor or from the comfort of his own home. I picked this image for this slide with the title Modern Greece Identity, because having this contemporary magazine as a practical example, we can see now the aspects that define modern Greek identity, or in other words, what Greeks believe that defines their own identity. So they have picked these images for this magazine. And now something that also Vasilis said in his introduction, if the identity stays the same. The question of identity appears simple, but in fact is extremely complex and extremely important, without meaning that it's something negative, as people believe, as Vasilis said. But because the identity has a double function, both functions are very important. Which are these two functions, according to the sociologists, of an identity? The first is to bring together a group of people, to create a link, or to create a glue, metaphorically. And it is because of that glue, we have an identity, that we constitute an entity inside a chaotic environment of humanity. We like it or not, it is a chaotic environment, and we have, all of us, have a glue with a specific group of people. The second function of the identity is external. The second function of the identity is that through our identity, we are recognized by others as an entity, as a group. So the life of the community, which can be a national community, or if you want, a religious community, the survival, the progress of the community depends on the way that this community is elaborating and managing its own identity. We feel, when we belong to a community, that our identity remains the same, as Vasilis said. Of course, many elements of the identity do remain the same. I was born Greek, I'm still Greek. But at the same time, the identity is such a healthy concept, which is adapting all the time, because the world is changing, and this is good, and because our community has to adapt. And if you want, has to adapt in order to survive. It adapts through the redefinition and the reinterpretation of its identity. And I will give you a practical example. So if we look at the Greek identity today, the Greek identity, let's say, in the 50s, or the Greek identity during the 19th century, or in the beginning of the 20th century, we will find out that this identity is different, that it has different components. And if we are separated from the main environment, for example, we live far away from Greece, we found out that maybe the identity changes, but we do not change. And perhaps this might surprise us. For example, I was born, raised, educated, and lived in Greece for 33 years. And I live in Australia the last 8 years. I feel, because this is personally, that my Greek identity is still evolving in a healthy way. Why? I remain the same by speaking Greek language, by being a Greek Orthodox, and living at the same time in a multicultural environment. Greek Revolution is a major element of modern Greek identity. Like other periods in the history of Greece, has played a significant role in the shaping and understanding of its modern identity for two reasons. The first reason is that it expresses the major change in our history, from the Ottoman past to the national period. And I read somewhere that the English language does a good distinction between national and ethnic. So I'm using the adjective national period. And therefore, it is a fundamental reference, and it is important to define the reasons that we are together and we are a unified Greek society. The other reason is that from the outside world, we are recognized through this revolution, which is a historic moment and that has an enormous significance, not only for Greece, but for the whole Europe, for the West, for the world. So it is very important that we take this opportunity of the 200 years since the beginning of the Greek Revolution in order to understand and study the meaning of the Greek Revolution in our identity. We use the term Greek, of course, through the various periods, and within each period, in each context, the meaning is different. It's not the same. Now, what was the identity of our ancestors before the revolution? Because in order to define modern Greek identity, we have to see what was happening before. It was essentially based on religion. The community of our ancestors was a religious community, and this community had a specific name, which we all are aware of. It was the name of Rum community, which in Greek we call it Romi. And this term has not disappeared. We still have a strong memory of this terminology. We speak about Romiosini, which conveys an experience of resistance, of a certain culture, of a certain unity that is not exactly the same with the one associated with the period that it has been a Greek state. Also, many Greek speakers, apart from being a religious community, another characteristic of the identity before the revolution, it is regional. Many Greek speakers before the revolution identified more closely with the regions and specific locals. That is the reason that we see such a regional diversity in the Greek world emerging during the 400 years period of Ottoman influence, a period also known as Turkokratia. The Greek Revolution was a very important moment for the transition from the religious community and or regional community to the national state community. But this transition could not, of course, have happened from one moment to another. This transition has gone through the constitution of the Greek state, through the creation of the institutions like the universities, the academy, the school system, by the creation of a regular army where people could be together and learn things in the same way. in schools, in the army, in the academy, in the organizations. So we have a period of change, of evolution. And this transition has happened by the introduction or to the elements of the room identity, of elements that have been in a certain way imported. They were imported from Europe through the extraordinary admiration of Europe for ancient Greece, as Vasilis said, or the way they imagined ancient Greece. So we have a combination now, moving from the identity before the revolution, we're moving to another identity or to a continuation of an identity after the revolution. So we have now a combination of two elements, a traditional element, the religious Orthodox element, and then an important element, which is the neoclassist element. Those two things combined brought up the constitution of a new kind of identity, which is the modern Greek national identity. But we haven't defined yet modern Greek identity. But this identity, of course, preserves many elements of the past, and this, I consider, is a major element of its force. The Greek state that emerged after the war was an independent kingdom under the foreign tutelage, and hardly resembled, to be honest, the nation that the revolutionaries had advocated for. It would, in fact, be several decades before Greece acquired complete independence and adopted its present form. Significantly, however, the themes and the values that permeated the revolutionary discourse continue to influence and direct the state's development and remain prominent characteristics of the Greek identity in the present day. Speaking of the forces facing the formation of a single Greek state, in 1857, Zambelios wrote that the Greeks had to contend with three different but interrelated unities, which included Greek unity, which connects the regenerated Greece to ancient Greece, with Christian unity, which links the present struggle to all the struggles of the Christian religion, and to Roman unity, which springs from the Middle Ages and sets the limits of the modern Greek nation. In other words, three traditions are embodied in the people of Greece for the establishment of the nation: the historical, the spiritual, and the political. These unities continue to hold an important place in Greeks today. For instance, the modern Greek state scorns its Ottoman past and reduces the period of Ottoman rule to a dark period in Greek history, while concurrently emphasizing its classical Byzantine past and its revival after the Greek Revolution. Moving from the characteristics of modern Greek identity, which have their primary forms in the Greek Revolution, I would like to present the characteristics of schooling in Greece, but not all the characteristics, specific ones, just prior and after the Greek Revolution, and how the Greek national school system assisted in the construction of a Greek national identity. The church, during the revolution, ran the majority of the Greek schools in Ottoman Greece. In these schools, Greek Orthodox priests conducted lessons in reading and writing, as well as on the general tenets of the Greek Orthodox Christian faith. Greek education becomes more formalized and better organized. More schools are open, and the church devises a general framework for a curriculum. Overall, reading, writing, and the Greek Orthodox Christian religion were taught in the Greek church, which ran schools during the Ottoman rule. Greek children were also expected to attend church services, take communion, learn common Christian prayers, celebrate holidays, follow the sacraments, and of course, help the poor and the sick. While education for most Greek children, both girls and boys, did not go beyond the age of 8 or 9, the schools did help preserve a Greek national identity around the notions of the Greek Orthodox Christian religion. After the Ottoman colonial rule, education in Greece became an important institution of the ideological construction of a Greek national identity. While most people at the time identified with their families, their communities, and Greek Orthodox Christian religion, after Greek independence, people began to see themselves as members of a broader Greek nation. At first, the Greek state struggled in developing a notion of what it meant to be Greek, because once we gained our independence, we didn't, the Greeks, from one day to another, they were like in an illusion. They were trying to understand what is meant to be Greek now. Much of the country continued to look much like it had since the Ottoman colonial rule, and most citizens had yet to adopt a Greek national identity. Europe would see Greece as a bridge between East and West, and a transitory part of Europe. Issues of westernizing and modernizing Greece were also debated from a social and cultural, of course, standpoint. Greece wanted to be seen as European, but retain some of its traditional character that dated back to its Ottoman colonial past. The West, on the other hand, saw Greece as the cradle of Western civilization and as an integral part of European civilization, but at the same time understood that Greece did not partake in many of the cultural, political, and social achievements of the West. What Westernization meant to Greece and the West, moreover, different. One aspect of this was the secularization of institutions. Many Western European states had adopted secular models for their schools. Greece, on the other hand, was reluctant to let go of its historical relationship between church and schooling. In the end, the Greek school would do away with much of its Ottoman past and look to the West and its ancient roots when developing its notion of what is meant to be Greek. The first schools after the Greek Revolution had three common goals: to create a literate citizenry, expand the agricultural and commercial sectors of the country, and unite the Greek people around a Greek national identity. Of great importance to the state was uniting the Greek nation around a collective national identity, where the nation, as an imagined community, would feel that it was part of a broader national community, whose members shared similar social and cultural practices, as well as a common historical experience. Ultimately, the national curriculum, Greek national curriculum, and school textbooks would help to accomplish these goals. After Greek independence war, education played a critical role in transforming Greek society. It was much like the rest of Western Europe that the education was to provide citizens an opportunity to an education that was free, democratic, and open to all citizens. The modern school was thus recognized to be efficient. Children packed in classrooms, sitting in rows of desks, while they listened to a teacher who presented them information. And the noun, it's not, it was like the teacher, and she or he was just presenting and not teaching, presenting information. Learning was designed to be systematic, orderly, and effective. A formal education also became valued. Why? It was a way out of poverty. It gave one a certain degree of social and cultural capital, but it also united people around a collective national identity. National identity consists of specific characteristics that make particular national group distinct from other national groups, and this was created through education. Thus, for most Greeks today, being Greek means speaking the Greek language, being Greek Orthodox, inhabiting lands that have been inhabited by Greeks for centuries, and being the descendant of the ancient Greeks. Nations are formed around communities that share a common religion, language, and set of customs, and are strengthened by the creation of a national history that focuses on the accomplishments of the community's heroes, inventors, scientists, artists, writers, and philosophers. Such effects can be realized and propagated through a nationalized school system and the mass publication of books, of course. Books are written about the history of the nation, which is taught then to children. Thus, I would like to give now some examples of how the Greek Revolution is actually presented in the today's Greek school textbooks. And this is an image from the history school textbook of year 6. Ottoman rule is presented as an assault on Greek religion. Why? Because it was expected that the Greeks would replace Orthodox Christianity with Islam. But the conquered Greek people were strong enough to ward off any forceful religious conversion. Ancient Greek figures and the leaders of the Greek Revolution are also idealized and presented as national models in the Greek school textbooks and are portrayed in Greek history books as patriots and heroes, as defenders of the nation, devout followers of the Greek Orthodox Church and the ideal models of Greekness and Hellenism. And of course, apart from the aspect of defending the nation back in 1821, today's Greek school textbooks present the Greeks of 1821 as defenders, of course, of the Greek Orthodox religion. For example, here in the Greek school textbook of history, we see the announcement of the Greek Revolution by Alexander Ypsilantis with the motto Mahou Hyperpisteos ke Patridos. And then the students are being asked here, it's not very clear to you, the question, ποια είναι τα συναισθήματα των ανθρώπων πίσω στο 1821. So the students have to think what motivated them, the people back then in 1821. And I think the verb motivate is not the correct one. What gave them strength back then? So, Mahou, Hyperpisteos και Patridos. And here, είναι ο όρκος των φιλικών, που λέει, ορκίζομαι στο θέλημα του Θεού. So, everything is in Greek school textbooks. Apart from books, as I said in the beginning, museums also reflect in a transparent way national identities, not only the Greek museums, but the museums around the world. Today, museums in Greece display relics from ancient Greece and the Greek Revolution to help reinforce the idea of a continuous history and survival of the Greek nation. A recent exhibition started in March 2021 in the Museum of Kykladic Art in Athens is a series of paintings and sketches which illustrate the theme of Greek Revolution, emphasizing the fact that the people rising up were Christians, yet another reason why the Europeans sided with them. Ancient monuments, naval battles, portraits of figures, Phi Hellenes, as well as the first royal couple, Otto and Amalia, draw the visitor's attention. Also prominent are the sculptures crafted by foreign artists as well as by the Greek counterparts after they had earned their freedom. The aim of the exhibition is to monumentalize the struggle with their tools, to lend the heroes of 1821 the immortality of ancient statues. And this is from this is an image from a photo, not an image, a photo from the exhibition in the Museum of Cycladic Art, and we can see the paintings of Otto and Amalia, which are paintings ένας πολύ γνωστός, μια πολύ γνωστή οικογένεια, η οικογένεια Μαρίνου, δάνεισε προσωρινά αυτούς τους πίνακες για την έκθεση αυτή. As a mother, as an educator, and as a Greek Australian citizen, I have the core belief that the books are tools of creating national identities. And we can change the verb create and say influencing national identities. And also museums, apart from reflecting national identities, they reflect the voices, the needs, the interests of the communities they serve in order to survive. Museums evoke concerns and foster ideas. So I've picked this photo from the exhibition, trying to wrap up today's presentation and quoting Fanny Maria Tsigaku, who is the exhibition's director, who points out that this exhibition's works demonstrate, and these are her exact words, demonstrate the need of modern Greeks to build their identity on antiquity, and more specifically, to build their national identity on the Greek Revolution's achievements. And this shows exactly, let me say, the diachronic value, as Vasilis said at the beginning, of the Greek Revolution, and its important bearing to the formation of modern Greek identity. So the exhibition, which takes place nowadays in Greece, expresses, according to the director of the museum, expresses the need of Greeks, of contemporary Greece, Greeks, to form their identity by taking characteristics from antiquity, and more specific, from the Greek Revolution. So this confirms what Vasilis was saying in the beginning, that modern Greek identity, and to be more specific, Greeks nowadays feel even stronger the need of feeling the characteristics of religion, language, culture in their identity. And identity, of course, it's not, it's been characterized as bad or as something negative because you have to be identified, but what you see now in front of you, you give characteristics to me, and this is what is myself. So what Greek Revolution has given to us today, it has not given us the religion or the freedom to believe, or the language, or the freedom to speak Greek language, but has given us something stronger than that, the need to have a strong religion, Orthodox religion, to speak Greek in order what, as Ernest Renan defined the nation, to survive. A nation can't survive without having strong beliefs, without having a language, traditions, culture, customs, and religion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Patricia, for this wonderful overview. Yeah, starting with generally what identity is all about, theoretically, and then going into more specific details up to the point of implementing the theoretical tools in the case of the example of the Greek Revolution and modern Greek identity. I think that you gave us a very balanced presentation, because it's very easy, you know, when you talk about identity, to take extremes. But yours was quite balanced, and we have to, as we say in Greek, na lemeta sika sika ke diskafi skafi. So, I mean, we have to see things as they really are, and identity is not a simple thing, that's for sure. It's quite complex, but it's our thing, and what we have to struggle with in order to be. Now it's open, the floor is open to questions. Or comments, or even disagreements, why not?
Η Επανάσταση δεν μας έδωσε τη θρησκεία, τη γλώσσα. Η Επανάσταση μας έδωσε την αξία αυτών. Γι' αυτό και οι σημερινοί Έλληνες νιώθουν ακόμα περισσότερο την ανάγκη να τα κρατήσουν αυτά, γιατί αυτό θα τους βοηθήσει, όπως είπα, να κάνουν survive, να επιβιώσουν στους αιώνες. Γιατί τους άλλους μέσα από αυτά επιβιώσαν στους αιώνες.
Εγώ θα ήθελα να ρωτήσω τη γνώμη σου, your opinion. Presumably, identity is a continuity from antiquity to Byzantium. There is a continuity there.
Of course.
But at the same time, there is a discontinuity.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we wouldn't be really talking about a continuity. We would be talking about something seamless, something unchanging, something that would be, you know, there and wouldn't change at all. But continuity is a more subtle notion. There's a continuity, which means that there are discontinuities. How strong do you think that these, you know, let's say, discontinuities, these changes, these gaps have been? How strong, and if that's something negative, or is, could it have been at the same time positive?
Να μιλήσω ελληνικά σε αυτό. Δεν μπορούμε να φανταστούμε την ελληνική ταυτότητα, and let's say the modern Greek identity, χωρίς να σκεφτούμε, για παράδειγμα, το Βυζάντιο, όπως είπες, or την ελληνική επανάσταση. Και αν θέλετε, όσο και traditional μπορεί να ακούγεται αυτό, ή την ελληνική γλώσσα. Και ακόμα περισσότερο, τη θρησκεία. Φυσικά, δεν ζούμε όπως ζούσαν στο Βυζάντιο ή όπως ήταν κατά τη διάρκεια της Ελληνικής Επανάστασης. And as I said, όπως ήταν ακριβώς και μετά, όταν γίναμε the Greek, we became independent, δεν είμαστε όπως μετά το 1932. There is a continuity στα βασικά σημεία, όπως το βλέπουμε και τώρα. Αλλά αυτό που συμβαίνει, τα gaps που είπες εσύ, που πολύ σωστά το είπες, τώρα οι νέοι Έλληνες, να το πούμε έτσι, modern Greeks, feel the need of what? Of reinforcing, να τα ενδυναμώσουν αυτά τα στοιχεία. Για ποιο λόγο? Γιατί μέσα από το continuity, Βασίλη, υπάρχουν εκεί εποχές, και αυτό είναι φυσιολογικό, και οι γενιές που τα χάνουν αυτά. Και πρέπει να συμβεί αυτό πολλές φορές, ώστε να πάμε πίσω και να δούμε τι μπορούμε να πάρουμε από αυτό. Από το unified nation. Μπορεί κάποιος να πει εδώ πέρα, γιατί είναι η Ελλάδα unified nation right now? Είναι ένα κράτος το οποίο το χαρακτηρίζει the unity? Εγώ μπορεί να πει, βλέπω τις ειδήσεις και δεν βλέπω κάτι τέτοιο. Υπάρχουν αυτά τα gaps και πρέπει να υπάρχουν. Γιατί αυτά φαίνουν στην επιφάνεια τις ανάγκες του λαού. Όπως και το revolution, η επανάσταση, ήρθε γιατί οι άνθρωποι, they felt there is a need here for a Greek independent nation. Γι' αυτό και επαναστατήσανε. Είχανε σχολεία. Είχαν το κρυφό σχολείο και πολλά άλλα σχολεία. Είχανε. Αλλά νιώσαν την ανάγκη ότι αυτά πρέπει να τα διεκδικήσουν, να είναι δικά τους. Και όταν μετά μπήκανε στην Ευρώπη, όχι μόνο όταν μπήκαν επίσημα, αλλά και μετά όταν γίνανε ανεξάρτητο κράτος, η Ευρώπη είχε τα δικά της συστήματα. Και τότε νιώσα την ανάγκη, τι θα κάνουμε εμείς με τα δικά μας τα σχολεία. Επομένως, υπάρχει η συνέχεια. Και όπως είπαμε, the identity stays the same, but at the same time it evolves, εξελίσσεται και πρέπει να εξελίσσεται. Χωρίς όμως, αν θέλετε να σας, άμα σχηματίζαμε τι σχήμα να έχει το identity, it's like a circle που έχει έναν άξονα. Ο άξονας είναι πάντα ο ίδιος. Αν φύγει ο άξονας από έναν κύκλο, ο κύκλος θα χαθεί. Ο άξονας πρέπει να μένει ο ίδιος, σταθερός. Με τη θρησκεία, τη γλώσσα, την κουλτούρα, τον πολιτισμό και ό,τι άλλο εσείς θέλετε. Όμως γύρω τα χαρακτηριστικά συνέχεια αυξάνονται. Και πρέπει να αυξάνονται. Χωρίς όμως να αλλάζει the main thing, the core system of the Greek national identity. Το οποίο κάνει fill up the gaps τα οποία εσύ είπες.
Σου κάνω καμιά ερώτηση. Γιατί γίνεται το είδε. Η οποία έχει περισσότερο σχέση με εδώ, με την δική μας πραγματικότητα, στην Αυστραλία. Συνηθίζουμε να λέμε ότι είμαστε Έλληνο-Αυστραλοί. Καταλαβαίνω πόσο σημαντικό είναι, φέτος που γιορτάζουμε τα 200 χρόνια, για μας ο εορτασμός αυτός και ο εμβαπτισμός σε αυτή τη μνήμη από την πλευρά του πρώτου συνθετικού, του Έλληνο-Αυστραλού. Μας διατηρεί σε σχέση με ό,τι ελληνικό. Τι θα έλεγες για το δεύτερο συνθετικό, δηλαδή εμείς ως Έλληνο-Αυστραλοί εδώ, στην Αυστραλία σήμερα, αύριο, μεθαύριο, ή μες στην επόμενη γενιά, τι έχει να μας πει η Επανάσταση για το κομμάτι το εδώ, δηλαδή, γιατί αυτό είναι σημαντικό. Βλέπουμε πολλές φορές παιδιά που αντιλαμβάνονται ότι, εντάξει, είναι σημαντική αυτή η στιγμή, αλλά πέρα από αυτό, δεν βλέπουν πώς έχει σχέση όντως με την πραγματικότητα.
Νομίζω ότι έκανες και την ερώτηση, αλλά έδωσες και την απάντηση μαζί. Ότι τα παιδιά δεν βλέπουν, they are not aware of the Greek Revolution. Δεν διδάσκονται την Ελληνική Επανάσταση. Ή δεν τη διδάσκονται, όπως για παράδειγμα μπορεί να τη διδαχτούν στο σχολείο, και αυτό είναι φυσιολογικό. Γι' αυτό πάμε πίσω, πάμε εμπρός πίσω που λέμε, είναι λίγο περίεργη η φράση. Τα παιδιά πρέπει να διδαχτούν την Ελληνική Επανάσταση και ακόμα περισσότερο εδώ. Όχι γιατί είναι Έλληνο-Αυστραλοί, αλλά γιατί τι θα πάρουν από αυτό το movement, από αυτή την Επανάσταση, τι τους δίνει αυτό εδώ στην Αυστραλία. Βέβαια, για να είμαι ειλικρινής, γιατί είμαι και εγώ μητέρα, θεωρώ ότι η κοινωνία εδώ, θα φύγω λίγο από τα παιδιά, θα το πω γενικά, το ζει δυνατά. Όλο αυτό. Και το ζει, αν θέλετε να το πω, και με ήθος. Γιατί αυτό που λείπει nowadays, it's the ethos. We use the same word in English. Και στην Ελλάδα γιορτάζουν το 1821, δεν γνωρίζω πώς, για να είμαι ειλικρινής, και εδώ το γιορτάζουμε. Εγώ αυτό που ζω εδώ, δεν κρίνω από το σημερινό, γιατί γίνονται πάρα πολλά πράγματα, έχει μια ηθική. Και οι επαναστάτες του 1821 είχαν ηθική. And to be more specific, they had values. Αυτό που λείπει σήμερα, and the gaps are being created, because people don't have values. Και μέσα στα values αυτά θα βάλω και το religion, τη θρησκεία, θα βάλω τη γλώσσα, θα βάλω τον πολιτισμό, όλα αυτά θα εντάξω μέσα. Επομένως, αυτό λείπει που η Επανάσταση μπορεί να τους διδάξει. Το μάχου υπερπίστεως και πατρίδος. Για παράδειγμα, μόνο αν δείξεις στα παιδιά εδώ, στα Έλληνο-Αυστραλάκια, τον όρκο, την προκήρυξη της Επανάστασης, αυτό τα λέει όλα. Αυτό συμπυκνώνει, είναι μια πολύ ωραία περίληψη, όλο αυτό που έγινε τότε. Επομένως, καλύπτεται το Έλληνο-Αυστραλό. Εγώ, βέβαια, για να επαναλάβω, θεωρώ ότι έτσι όπως τα παιδιά μας εδώ ζούνε, όχι μόνο την Επανάσταση, την Εθνική Εορτή, τα Χριστούγεννα, αν θέλετε, το Πάσχα, για μένα έχει μια ηθικότητα και πρέπει να δούμε, να ξέρουμε πάντα, όταν κρίνουμε, από πού το κρίνουμε. Είμαστε πολύ μακριά από την Ελλάδα. Για παράδειγμα, όταν γιορτάζουμε την εθνική μας επέτειο, ο περίγυρός μας, το περιβάλλον μας, our environment, δεν το γιορτάζει. Όταν είμαστε τη Μεγάλη Παρασκευή έξω, η γειτονιά δεν γιορτάζει. Επομένως, εμείς είμαστε ακόμα περισσότερο πιο γενναίοι, δεν ξέρω ποιο επίθετο να πω, σε αυτόν τον ερωτισμό και στην ουσία, Βασίλη. Γιατί εγώ τη Μεγάλη Παρασκευή στη δουλειά μου δουλεύουν κανονικά όταν το Ορθόδοξο Πάσχα δεν πέφτει με το Καθολικό. Επομένως, ακόμα περισσότερο είμαστε εμείς κοντά στην έννοια και στο believing, να πιστεύεις ταυτόχρονα.
Και αυτή η λέξη, φυσικά, το πρόσωπο, έχει θεολογική σημασία για μας και για μας η Επανάσταση, αν θέλετε, γίνεται μέσα μας. Και νομίζω, ίσως, στο βάθος, και το έχετε βάλει μέσα στο θέμα σας, που μιλήσατε για τη θρησκεία και τα λοιπά, και έτσι είναι αυτό που λέω και εγώ το ίδιο. Απλώς η λέξη, το πρόσωπο, επειδή είναι τα τρία πρόσωπα της Αγίας Τριάδας και εμείς είμαστε κατ' εικόνα Θεού, και γι' αυτό εμείς το βάρος πάντα ρίχνουμε σε αυτή τη λέξη, όχι τόσο πολύ στο identity. Και νομίζω και αυτή η επανάσταση που έγινε με τον Χριστό, που πήραν, ας πούμε, από τον Ελληνισμό και η Χριστιανισύνη τους πρώτους χριστιανικούς αιώνους, οι Καπεδόκες και όλα, και μεταφέρανε το ελληνικό στοιχείο μέσα στον Χριστιανισμό, και το πρόσωπο που είχαν στην αρχαία Ελλάδα, στο θέατρο κτλ., το αλλάξανε τελείως και το φέρανε, δώσαν άλλη σημασία πέρα από το identity, πέρα από τη σημασία που είχαν στο θέατρο, το αρχαίο που αλλάζαν τη μάσκα και τα λοιπά. Και τώρα εμείς έχουμε άλλη σημασία του προσώπου, γιατί ζήσαμε το πρόσωπο του Χριστού. Αυτό απλώς ήθελα να πω. Φυσικά εσείς το έχετε περιλαμβάνει όλα αυτά μες στην ομιλία σας και σας ευχαριστώ, αλλά απλώς αυτή η λέξη, νομίζω, ίσως είναι καλό να επεκτείνουμε λίγο. Θυμάμαι ένα conference που κάναμε εδώ για τη λέξη φιλοξενία, που δεν υπάρχει σε άλλη γλώσσα, συμπυκμένο έτσι σε μία λέξη. Και το φέραμε τελικά στο θέμα τη φιλοξενία, του Αβραάμ και τα λοιπά, τη Αγία Τριάδα και τα λοιπά. Και έτσι όλοι οι Αυστραλοί ήταν θαυμασμένοι από πώς αυτή η λέξη συμβολίζει τόσο πολλά πράγματα, γιατί περιλαμβάνει το πρόσωπο. Ευχαριστώ πολύ πάντως για όλα.
Να είστε καλά. Σε αυτό συμφωνώ, γιατί να σας πω, και εγώ είπα όταν μιλούσα, λέω, εσείς όταν βλέπετε εμένα βλέπετε μία ταυτότητα, identity, βλέπετε ένα identity, αλλά για να ορίσετε όπως εσείς πιστεύετε τη δική μου την ταυτότητα, βλέπετε το πρόσωπο, από εκεί ξεκινάνε όλα. Το πρόσωπο, βέβαια, στο θρησκευτικό κομμάτι έχει μία άλλη ερμηνεία, αν θέλετε να σας το πω έτσι, και μία επέκταση στην έννοιά του, ενώ το πρόσωπο σημαίνει κάτι άλλο. Τώρα, όσον αφορά το identity ή την ταυτότητα, το identity έχει να κάνει με characteristics. Όταν όμως εσείς λέτε το πρόσωπο του Χριστού, δεν δίνετε χαρακτηριστικά. Δίνετε πίστη, the belief that you have inside you. Η ταυτότητα όμως, λέμε, είσαι Greek Australian, όπως είπε ο Βασίλης, άρα ποια boxes θα κάνεις tick. Κάνεις tick κάποια boxes, ώστε at the end you have the result of Greek Australian identity. Or if you don't tick all the boxes, you have the Australian identity. Ενώ το πρόσωπο έχει να κάνει με αυτό που ο άλλος βλέπει. Ενώ το identity, η ταυτότητα έχει να κάνει με χαρακτηριστικά που χαρακτηρίζουν τον κάθε άνθρωπο, τον κάθε λαό, το κάθε κοινωνικό σύνολο, αν θέλετε να σας το πω έτσι. Και πολύ σωστά υπάρχει ο διαχωρισμός μεταξύ προσώπου και μεταξύ και ταυτότητας. Υπάρχει ο διαχωρισμός και πρέπει να υπάρχει, όχι μεταξύ θεολογίας και κοινωνιολογίας, αλλά και ως έννοια πρέπει να υπάρχει αυτή η διαφορά. Νομίζω ότι...
Ωραία. Το κλείνουμε κάπου εδώ. Το ολοκληρώνουμε.
Να ευχαριστήσω.
Πάρα πολύ.
Να είστε καλά.
Και επιφυλασσόμεθα.
Να είστε καλά. Καλό βράδυ.